All right, should we get started? Yes, we should. Okay, good, good. So this is, let's go back out of the iPad, back into PowerPoint. And then it pops back again like that. Or it should. Yeah, so again, these are the apps. And if you don't have these, then I can tell you what we're going to do. But we have... It says it's going to be really wildly interactive, and I built really kind of a nice 60-minute session, which we're going to cram into 40. So can you be the timekeeper? What time is this session supposed to end? 2:40? So at 2:33, would you tell me, go like that? Because we'll go into the interactive part. Because it's really a fun thing. Because here's the basic idea. Ooh, that's interesting. This would be a bad time for PowerPoint to stop working. Let's see. I do have a lot of things going on, so it may be that it's troubled. Hang on, let me see if I can start it again. Ah, here we go, okay. Remind me to go to escape before I stop next time. Anyway, this is these are the tools that we're gonna use, but you have over there at the top, that's how you follow somebody's Erasmus channel. It's a nice way to set up kind of a challenge, a tool challenge, or a scavenger hunt, or whatever you wanna do for students. So again, we're gonna go quickly through this, but that's how you follow somebody's channel on Erasmus. How many of you have Erasmus? Okay, how many of you follow another channel? Somebody else. It's kind of fun. You can follow other teachers and see what goes on. It's kind of neat, and you see all the stuff that they build. So we've built, and I'll tell you more about this as we move along, but some augmented books that kids all over the country can contribute to, and they become authors altogether. Anyway, this is about this, basically. It's about exposure. So we're going to see a lot of different stuff, and a lot of this is about the exposure you're going to have for your kids. Like, why do you have all this stuff? You know, 3D printers, and you have this Mio and this wireless mice and stuff like that. Part of it is that the world is moving so fast, we sort of have to turn over part of this to students. Bill Gates is a classic example for this, and Gates talked about this to Malcolm Gladwell, but there were maybe 5 kids in the world that had his environment when he went in. Maybe 5 kids that had a computer at their schools connected to the internet. So it's all about exposure, so we want to make sure that whatever our kids have and whatever gifts they have will open up through these technologies. And it wasn't just Gladwell, it was all these people. It wasn't just Gates. All these people are in Gladwell's book, but all of them benefited by being sort of in the right place at the right time. And you want to make sure your classroom is the right place and the right time for kids. And sometimes the only way to do that is in this world is to have a lot of these things going on and let them figure out what to do. So here's part of it, is we've got this world of wonders, and we want to have more I wonder in it. So we can't always figure out what this stuff's going to be. Sylvia Martinez was just here showing these great stuff of, you know, makers, the do-it-yourself stuff. You don't really know what they're going to be able to do, but if you say, I wonder how we could use this, I wonder how this would apply, then you get them thinking, and the only way you can get them to thinking about things that they don't have now is to expose them to things like we're going to play with. So that's how that stuff works. The classic example not to do with this is the USB pet rock. So I would suggest getting a USB pet rock and giving it out if somebody's just using the technology so that it's there in front of them, not doing it. So I don't know if you've seen this. You can actually get these things. Mine escaped. Look, here's the box. And seriously, I opened my suitcase and it wasn't there. So I don't know whether it fell out or it's roaming around Dulles Terminal or whatever. But it, basically, here's what this is. This is a, here's the directions. Locate your USB port, plug in your USB pet rock, 8 pages of instructions will show you exactly what it'll do when it's plugged in. And there are 8 blank pages in the user guide, because it doesn't do anything. It's a rock with a USB cord taped onto it, right? Glued onto it. That's all it is. So we want to make sure that we don't just have pet rocks going on in our classrooms. So you could have one and maybe give out the award if somebody's not really getting kids to wonder about stuff. So this is another classic. It's an example you can see. This is Google Glass, which is now going to the great beyond. I don't know if you saw the opening, but we sort of retired it. I married it with a laser disc, and they're now running off in the sunset. It's kind of fun, but basically it was mobile on a stick. And what it did was it made you think, gee, what if I didn't have to hold up my mobile? What if I could do other things with it? This is one of the
sky on our
Google,
glass,
by the way, is still supporting people like the doctors and teachers that have been using it in a very significant way. So they have committed to do that. So that'll be good for, you know, 6 weeks. Anyway, that's how that stuff works. Here is what it was really cool about, was when you had it
sky in a whole new way,
so that it would do an overlay, so you could go outside and look at the stars and the paths, the constellations, and be on top of it. That was pretty neat. Or when you're walking around to have the street maps laid out right in front of you, that was sort of the killer app for that. So part of it was the overlay idea. My favorite thing was it'll actually translate, right? So it'll translate, so you look through and it'll translate from English to Spanish and so forth. How many think that's a good idea? How many have Word Lens on your phones? All right, so not enough, so let me show you how this works. So let me hit escape this time. Let's go over to the iPad and take a look at the iPad. And this is an app called Word Lens. This, by the way, in case we don't see it later, this is actually looking at outer space on my iPad. There's a camera on the International Space Station that does a live feed. Is that not neat? I can look at outer space here, right? Rainer, we'll talk about that in a second. But so let's do a search for Word Lens, especially if you don't have it. This is really worth seeing, because again, it's something that's been around for a while, but people haven't really used it. And it can't be that they don't have second language learners in their class. How many of you have second language learners in your class, right? Everybody. So wouldn't it be useful if you could take something like USA Today, this is a free app, and in Word Lens, if I could translate that into Spanish, wouldn't that be cool? If only we had something like that. Oh, wait a minute. Yes, there it is. So that's a pretty cool thing. Look, here's Microsoft getting involved in Fresco Ciudad, cool city. That's how that stuff works. So this is Word Lens. You have to buy the dictionaries. The app is free. So you buy the dictionaries. The dictionaries are like $3, $4, something like that. And if you've ever bought a paper dictionary, you realize that's pretty cheap. Anyway, so that's Word Lens. It's another way that this thing is sort of like a tricorder, and we just have to then figure out how to use that in a good way. So let's go back now to PowerPoint and see. So that's how that kind of stuff works. So the International Space Station seems to be asleep right now, but let's talk about how that works. And again, all this stuff is in the handout, but this is where you can go and actually look at a live feed of the space station. Now, we just saw it, and it says that the high def feed is off, and that's because they have a shorter day, because they go around the Earth more than once every 24 hours. So you have to look at where it is. Here's, you can sort of tell where it is. They have your little map on there. This is not where it is now. It's more over here because it's dark. But I did make a video so you can see. But this is what you get. And it's so cool because actually you end up listening to their chatter. And it's moving kind of slow, but look, you can sort of see, right? Look, see how it's... So I was like watching this. So, I mean, it's outer space. So a kid can have outer space on their device, right? This goes through Ustream, it's live, and you can hear them chatting all the time. It's so funny, you know, Alan Rancher, we're doing a report over here. What do you think? It looks good to us from down here. You know, you hear all this chat, like flying. Anyway, the idea is that your kids have in their hands something they can do that with. Now, the other thing that's kind of cool, let me go back to the iPad. And I've done this a lot at FETC, but I never get tired of it. Does anybody here have a, can I get a volunteer? Somebody come up here? Okay, yes, would you come up here for me, please? Little does she know. Let's go back to the iPad. How many of you have $3 with you right now? Okay, because you'll be able to buy this. So here's this. And I put a little grommet here, right? Mm-hmm. See, it's a piece of, oh, hi. Nice to see you. Here's a little piece of rubber. Have I ever done this with you? This is kind of fun. And so what we have here, I'm going to go into the camera. We're going to look in the photos, and what this is, I'm going to spread it out. What this is a, and I'll turn on the light, is a 60 power microscope. See how that works? So I've gone from outer space, and I'll tell you what I'll let you do. Usually I do this myself, but go ahead and look at my scalp. Let's see what it looks like. Okay, you got to go all the way in there. We're looking for, how many of you looked for head lice before in your schools? So look, actual human hair. Now wait, because I've got a little trained bug. Okay, go. No, it's not there, but but isn't that neat? You can take pictures and everything else. Isn't that kind of cool? So, and it's got a light on it, it's got a UV light on it, and you just, I grew a 50-cent grommet over the camera hole. So I could do this on a mobile phone or anything else, so I've gone from outer space to my scalp. That's how good these things are. Could you use this?
Yeah.
Here, why don't you, here, you can, there's the, and the leatherette carrying case. So, how, and you say, gee, how much can that possibly be? So I went on Amazon last night, and you can get them for $1.45. This was $40 though. This one was $40, but just a good one. But thank you. Let's give her a hand. Thank you very much. So, how to do it is this is what it looks like, and here's a video on how to do it too. You just I did a video on how to do it, then this guy Tim did it because he actually had a studio. Then a kid did it and explained everything, and his is better and shorter and tells you how to do it. So all those links are in the handout. But essentially, you just glue a 50-cent half-inch grommet over the camera hole, and that little $1.45 microscope will screw into it. Which means you can look at leaves and look at moss, whatever you want to do, all that on the same device that we looked at outer space in just a few minutes ago. So anyway, that's how cool this stuff is. This is a video I actually made with the and edited on the iPad, but this is a grasshopper. Anyway, very exciting. This is a stunt grasshopper who gave up his leg for this. Anyway, that's it. So you get the idea. You can make videos, you can do all this stuff with material that's right there. This is, again, it was $1.90 at one time. Let's take a look at this. Can anybody guess what this is? This is something else you can do on the iPad. I'll do it right here because I made a video of it. But anybody know what that is? You want to take a guess? So let's take a look. We're going to zoom out and see. Let me know when you think you got a good clue on it. Excellent! Who said that? How did you get that? That's.
I did the same thing as my email profile.
There you go. So there is a thing called the Google. You want to say what it is? You remember the place where we found it?
No.
It's a Google Art Institute, and they have close-ups that they've scanned of famous pieces of art. So you could actually get in, did you notice, and see the brush strokes of Van Gogh. You can see the canvas, the holes in the canvas, the holes, the places in the canvas that have no paint. All of that you can access from the iPad through the Art Institute. And again, the link is there. But again, take another look. That's how close you can get. I don't know if you can see it up there, but you can sort of see the canvas underneath the paint. It's really cool. It's not just the Van Gogh, it's all these other pieces of art that you can go in and do it. The way they do it is they have this big scanner that they set up in front of the painting or the other piece of art, and it goes slowly down. So it can take days and days to do a single painting. But you have access to that. You have access to that. So that, anyway, that's pretty neat. So this is the site, the Google Cultural Art Institute, and there's the link, but you'll find it, and you get the ones that are scanned in high def, and it zooms all the way in. So again, very cool things to do with this, and then when you show this to kids, and let's say you're not even teaching art, but you show stuff like this because they're going to think then what they could use it for in another way. Maybe to look at a screw, a strip screw in the lawnmower. Maybe to look at their clothing to see whether they can patch up their coat or, you know, whatever it is. You show this stuff to them and let them take the next step. I mean, we're sort of at that point. We got to let them take the next step. This is another thing I just think is cool. Anybody have this app, Cardio? $1.99, I think the price varies, but here's what it does. It takes the camera inside a mobile phone. In this case, it was an iPhone, but that camera, if you run it through a computer algorithm, this is a close-up on his face.
To very accurately measure what the color intensity is at every point. So we measure those, we amplify them, and then add them back into the video to create a color magnified video, if you were.
You can see his heart beating through the blood flow to his face.
You can see how fast his heart's beating. You can also see a spatial pattern of when the blood
goes
where. On a mobile
phone.
So here's an example of the raw video. This is without any amplification. And now you can see that lets us extract the pulse. And we can do that as accurately as the conventional methods that have to touch the baby. We compared our measurement with an EKG that was attached to the baby at the same time. And they agree.
So how cool is that, right? That's how powerful these things are. So again, maybe you use the app and you bring it into a literature class, whatever you want to do, and you think about things. Here's this is a product that came about. Somebody got this going, but it's a way to check eyes when you're away from all those machines. How many of you have ever gotten an eye exam? Right? How many have it covered under your healthcare plans covered? Isn't that good? Anyway, you know, they say, is this better? Is this better? Take all those little lenses. You can do that with the camera lens in an iPhone, if you have, or another phone, if you have the computing power that's on board the machine. It'll do all that stuff for you. It'll say, this can be converted to this, can be converted to this. So we haven't thought about that. We're still lugging around these big devices because it's what we're used to. So you really want to get this in the hands of students, right? So you got to start using it. And you are here, you're sort of the literati in this, a digerati. They are using them already. Your kids are using them. Your teachers are using them. It's now a matter of saying expose your class to these so they get exposure in the same way that, that's from the International Space Station. We'll let them talk. Anyway, it's like the pilot on United. Anyway, you want to find a way to get core curriculum into those devices. That's why you want a digital textbook. It's why you want a digital math book. It's why you want a digital social studies book, because then you don't have any choice. Then you hand them out, and if your kids are going to do social studies, they got to do it. So it's one of the reasons to get a digital product, because if you don't, it's going to be very hard for good and experienced teachers to make that leap, because this is all extra otherwise. It's all extra otherwise. If you can move core curriculum to your digital device, then you're in better shape. All right, we can talk about that later if you want. So this is an app, I think. This is now augmented reality. This is, again, something that your kids can build, and I'll tell you how we're building this. We're building the largest augmented reality book in the world so far in Texas at the end of this month. So I was in London. Were any of you at the share out? You saw some of this? Oh, if you weren't, this is new. That's great. So in London, they have pictures of the old old London, right? London hadn't changed that much. The ones that Germans, the buildings, the Germans didn't blow up. And this is what they did. They put a layer in, so when you walk around, you can actually, if you're at the right street, it overlays the old image on top of the new image. In other words, you're walking around, and the pin tells you you're in a place, and you hold it up, and you can see what was like 50 years ago. I guess now 70 years ago, right? Which is so neat. So here's what it can look like. This is, so I was there, and the overlays float around like plates in the sky, sort of. They float and float, and when you line it up, it goes like this and gets in front. Just so, anyway, it's a free app, but that's London then. This is web-based, but this is in France. This is what it used to look like, right? A long time ago. What if you're on the beaches of Normandy and you can look around and see what happens? See why you're not speaking German in Paris. You know what I mean? So this is sort of how that stuff works. So this is in New York, same thing. I talked to Kathy Schrock. One of her jobs was to go around and find buildings. I think it was in Boston that they had old pictures for, and find the new pictures and take the pictures that were of exactly the same spot. So this stuff is out there. And it means that these are New York City crime photos that they've overlaid over the city. So this is, I think they're talking a woman off the ledge. She's having none of it, right? It's like, keep away from me. But this is how that stuff works. So you can overlay stuff like this now. This is a class, and you know what? We're now in a new school year, and I haven't checked this out to see if it still works. But this is, what's the augmented reality app called? What is it called? Yes, Erasmus, which is spelled A-U-R-A-S-M-A. A-U. A-U-R, there it is. Erasmus. And when you launch that, you see layers on everything. How many people have not seen Erasmus before? Have not? Okay. Well, I don't do this often, but it means that you can build onto any object. This is a $20 bill. If I hold it over the 20, you can tell me. Wait, here. I'm spelling it out for you to help, and no one's telling me that no one can see it. Anyway, here's, so that's Erasmus. This is, take a look.
Terry, heads up.
So see what's happening to the 20? Let me turn up the sound. So watch the numbers. And the national anthem's actually playing. What we're hearing is a space station, but we're going to zoom in on the...
But we'll get back with you on our floor plan.
That's right. And this is the White House, Houston. Anyway, so that's... Isn't that cool? And like, look, it's just the object is there. So this is Erasmus, right? So it's free. You can get it. Here's a class that has built stuff. And again, I haven't checked to see if these are still... Yeah, here they go. And I got to turn up the sound, but so when this kid, this is the yearbook picture, right? When you, I follow this teacher's channel, Ray Burke. So when I hold it over, I actually can see then what that kid has decided with her team to put as a trigger on her picture. So it means that your kids can build stuff like this for free. So what we're going to do in Texas is at the end of this month at the Barbara Bush Library, we're going to have kids from all over the country, we think all over the world. They did this last year. It's a readout. Barbara Bush comes, and there's a reading with kids, fifth, eighth grade. And then anybody that watches it on live stream gets sent a copy of the book.
Nope,
they gave out 60,000 books last year, which, again, pretty cool. Here's the thing, though.
Thank you.
We're going to do it with an augmented reality book. So this is the information. It's in the handout. So they picked a book on Mount Rushmore. We're having kids sign up on a Google Doc to say, we want to do an augmentation of this illustration in the book. So when we send out the book, those 60,000 books, everybody that gets it will see those kids' work. We're able to build it virtually with kids all over the world. It goes in the book, and as long as they follow the Reading Adventure channel in Erasmus, they'll get to see other kids saying, and here's how you dynamite Lincoln's nose, or whatever it is they're going to do. You know what I mean? But you're going to see layers like that in there. So that's how that stuff works. Again, we're just trying to do stuff. We are also doing this for Price Waterhouse. They're sending out to schools a financial literacy module. It's for elementary kids. If you're interested in financial literacy, talk to me or just do a search for Price Waterhouse Cooper. But we're with their trainees, we're building video explanations that go along with the book. So when a kid opens up and explains what supply and demand is, you also have a college kid going, here's what supply is, look, I've got this, or whatever they're doing, you know what I mean? So they do that. So this is, again, things you can sort of do. So any questions about that? So those are augmentations, which are neat. And one of the fun things for me is that now this is already beginning to move into the vocational arts. How many think there's a place for apprenticeships in the United States? Yes, it's huge. The jobs are there. Everything's there. But how many people do not have industrial arts at your school? Do not have. I mean, they sort of went away, right? People said, oh, let's all go to keyboarding and things like that. So this is, I was at the California School Boards Association meeting earlier this year, and this is a virtual welding kit. So this is the superintendent of Napa County in California, who's welding.
Pretty good weld right there.
All right, now I'm going to show you what you did, all right? See that? If you have that, I mean, it's a little thick, but you would want to do that the whole way. See this right here? That's something that was already there. That's what you want the whole route to look like. That's called the route pass.
And see, they can actually pull in NASA from that thing. Should I mute the NASA guys? Kind of fun to hear them, but here it is again. Here's the space station. It's pulling up the feed, and I'll turn the sound down, and I'll go over here, and I'll turn the iPad sound up. So here's, again, let me move this up here. Here's what I forgot to do is turn this volume up. So what you see is, I'll show you, since we've got a Erasmus open, if you do it with the $20 bill, what you hear is the Star Spangled Banner. Anybody want to sing the Star Spangled Banner? Anyway, so same deal, you just have the sound. So when you're connecting your iPad through the USB cable in Yosemite, you got to always remember to turn up the sound. Anyway, so that's more you can do. So that's industrial arts. That those machines are expensive. This is sort of what they do. They've been around for a while. But again, this is virtual welding. Virtual welding. Yeah. So the trades can also take advantage of all the stuff that's happened with these augmented realities. So this is a virtual reality of welding. And this is, you're learning how to do it underwater. You're learning how to do it on a ship. All that stuff can happen there. How many people think it's a good idea? How many people think it'd be a good idea for a BMW mechanic to have it? So here's the... So this is not fiction. This is out there now. And this is a BMW. And through the glasses, you see the augmented parts on top.
Release two screws.
It shows and tells you how to take the screws out, right? Now, it doesn't do it for you yet. That's 6 months away. But it's, kidding. But how many people think this is a good idea? So will we be able ultimately to repair something else we do? Probably yes, probably yes. So that brings us then to some of the more interesting things that you can have in a class. This is one, let's go to the leap motion. Can I have another volunteer? Another volunteer? This is kind of fun. All right, yes, come over here. Pulling all the volunteers from the other side. So this is a little device. It looks like this. And so they cost $79. They're wireless mice. So you can control your computer with it, but you can do more than that. So what we want to do with you, we got to have that thing turn green, there it is let's get out of here and we'll go over to this. This is one of the, look, this will pull up. All right, so go ahead and just put your hands over this thing. Wait till it tell you a second. Kind of here. There you go. Try your other hand too. So spread them out. That didn't have to be that close. It can be right up here, like here. So she's able to like move her hands around, right? So let me. You ready for a task? Would you like a task? So try this one. And this is one thing that some people are really intuitive at, and some are not. Let's do the, let me go, I think it's in here. Hang on, let's see. So let's do it. It'll give you the spooky sound coming in. So this is, you know, it doesn't necessarily replace a clicker for a lot of stuff. Now put your hands up there. Yeah, put them. Okay, now you got a vote. So what we should have, and yeah, you can move around. Now eventually what's going to happen is, press any key to continue. That would be a good thing. So now you can try to pick up these objects. So you're going to see little objects here. There you go. So try to pick up, and again, remember you're up here, not over the, there you go. Yeah, again, so again, you remember you're in this invisible space up here. But yeah, it's for some people it's easy, for some people it's hard, but you're trying to pick those things up. So would you get good at this with practice? Yeah. So there's her hands, look, she's trying, you gotta zoom in and out and all that kind of stuff, you get a sense of distance and everything else, but that's how this is. Now, when would this be useful? Not so much as a standalone thing, but when we go into that world with the Oculus, when you're in a totally immersive environment, then you're gonna wanna be able to do stuff. So here, let me kind of guide your hand, like you wanna be kind of there, not try to pick it up, drop down a little bit on top of that thing. So again, it's gotta be over here, so there you go. So now, go ahead, try to, you've gone right through the plane. Now, if doctors are doing this on somebody in Tanzania, that patient's in real trouble. You know what I'm saying? But that's how you do. So you practice with it. You can do Google Earth with it. You can zoom in and out, do all this stuff. Anyway, it's a leap motion. It's about $79. Let's give her a hand. Thank you very much. So, you know, you practice. Look, you practice and you learn how to do stuff. But, like, I'm knocking them over, doing stuff like that. But this becomes useful when you talk about a totally immersive environment. You'd be able to do that. So the other thing, here's an example of how that can work. This is, they just came out with this. When you're in an immersive environment, one of the things you want to be able to do is go in and out. Uh-oh, did I just lose my video? I did. When I plugged that in and out, hang on, let me... Sometimes with PowerPoint, let me just restart this. I'll do it again. When you play with it on the side, you end up losing your ability to play videos. So that's the augmented reality part goes with the things that we saw at the beginning, the Oculus, the Samsung device, the new Microsoft device that works in that way. So what we want to do is, let me pull this back up again. Now we'll have the videos back. Is I'm also wearing, and it's not time to let anybody do this because you have to calibrate your hands, this thing, which is called a Myo. So the Myo goes on your arm and it lets you control things with your arm. It reads the muscles and the way the muscles expand and contract on your arm, so you can do things like turn the volume up and down and change the PowerPoint slides like this. So it's called a Mayo. Let me show you what it looks like rather than do it, because we're going to run out of time. But these are, again, the leap motion, which she played with, connects to your machine. This connects to you. This connects to you and has a little USB port that goes in and looks at it. So here's what they look like when you use them. And they have to get warm. You have to warm them up first, which is kind of cool. But it's called a Mayo. And here's how it works. Here we go. Our video should return. So you see he's wearing it. Here we go.
I'm trying out Mayo today. This band
so watch the screen.
Your arm, and it reads your gestures, and it actually lets you control the devices around you. With Mayo, I've been able to turn the volume of a television set up and down.
There you go. Volume's going up. Awesome.
To rewind and fast forward a video. I've been using Mayo out with a toy card, actually moving your arm to move this little car left.
So that's right. The coolest part. See, he's controlling the little device underneath. So that, again, right now, will it replace this? I don't think so. This is $200. This is like $19 at Home Depot. I don't think I'm going to be changing my PowerPoints with that. But here's where it goes. This is from MIT. This is the Internet of Things.
The smart device only requires a processor and a Wi-Fi connection to a server.
So when you get wired devices, this is behind the door.
Be applied on the door.
This is behind the door,
whereby a virtual access system grants access to the door.
So there's no lock. There's no keypad on the outside of the door.
Whereby light switch.
You have to have it on a mobile
on
device.
Off,
so they're not controlling lights the same way.
Changes the light color.
So watch, the lights will change on the mobile device. So they're interacting with the real world through their mobile device. And you see this in the Nest and a lot of other stuff that's happening. But again, look at it. Imagine this now, if I wasn't controlling it with my mobile, but I was controlling it with my wrist.
The concept can
like
also
I was doing this,
on the door opening
and it opened up.
Whereby
so that's not that far away. If I turn the doorknob like this, I could do it right now with this device. Right? I could do this, and it would read it, and it would open the device. So it means that some of the stuff we wear is going to control some of the objects around us, which is pretty neat. Anyway, that's how this stuff works. Again, you expose students to this and let them figure out what it could possibly do. So you show this, you experiment, somebody's going to have an idea. Now, we may not have 150 Bill Gates on our middle school rosters, but everybody's gifted at something, and the more we explore, right, the more they'll get to do it. So the last thing before we do the interaction is there's the mini-me here, so I'll just show you this. This is kind of fun. I went down to a scanner. This was in a mini mall in San Diego, and I went in, and they had this little booth where they take your picture, and when they take your picture, then it goes into a computer right away,
basically. Yeah.
And then you can print out yourself. So
yeah,
this is,
pretty good.
And again, this was a lot more remarkable a year ago. That's the giant printer, which looks like a coffin. And if you print it out, here's what it is. I brought the mini-me. So here it was. This is me. Come up and take a look at it. It's kind of fragile. It can come right off of the thing, but isn't it kind of cool, huh? Yeah. Question? 233? Oh, thank you very much. So anyway, that's the mini-me. If you want to do it with your kids and you have a Kinect camera, you can go and they'll do it on Shapeify. The last time I checked the price, it was $59. They're about this big. But you get a device. If you have a Kinect camera and a Microsoft machine, that camera will do it. Makes a file. You send them the file and $59, and they send you back a U that's about this big. So how cool is that? Now, again, that's pretty nifty. What Sylvie Martinez showed before was better. Prosthetic devices, all kinds of other stuff, the ability to print out stuff in the space station and so forth. Okay, so now we're going to do an interactive thing. How many people have those apps? Have Shazam, okay, so I can tell you how this works, but let's let them get started. So you'll need to have a partner because you're going to need two devices. So this will be fun, and then how to do this is actually here. So here's people doing it at the California Technology Conference, right? So they're all taking this challenge. These are the people that won. I did it also in Nashville. So it's kind of tricky, but it takes these apps, and here's what they do. And give me till 3:40, and I think you'll may want to try this with your class. Shazam reads data from music, right? When music plays, it tells you what the song is and the artist and the copyright, even lets you order it, right? All that information is on the music. QR codes read information from a QR code, right? And Erasmus reads information from an object, So you ready to start this quiz? Ready to go? And again, let's give it a few minutes for the people that have these apps, and then I'll walk you through it, but I'll tell you how wonderfully perplexing this can be for people. So it's a way to use these apps to make you think, gee, maybe we could do this with something else. Are you ready to start? And if you know what you think you do, you can just shout it out if you don't have all those apps. Okay, ready? And this is all the beginning I've ever done. You'll be sitting for a while going like that. All right, ready to start? All right. Feeling groovy, yes, but what song is it? 59th Street Bridge song, right. And it's not in the title. It only comes up on Shazam. They never say the song title. So now what would you do next? Think, group. What do we do next? What do? We do Erasmus and we look at which bridge? The 59th Street Bridge, right? So without giving you any clues, you've had to sort of figure that out. Now, if you wanted to do Erasmus, should we do it? Should I bring up the bridge picture? You can actually, if you were doing this and it was an open room, did you get it? Did it show up? Okay, let me, you go to this, here's where it is. It's Link YY Bridge 1, so let me pull up just that picture. I'm gonna pull up just that picture. So here is, so you'd go to exactly where you needed to be. This is linkyy.com/ The clue you were given was that it was 59th Street Bridge, and then here's the, assuming the internet will pull it up for me, here's the, I posted this in a Google Doc, so you then go and here's the picture of the bridge. Now this should be able to pull up, this ought to be able to pull it up from where you're sitting. Come on, bridge. There we go. Well, did you just fall asleep? No. Here we go. So now you ought to be able to see that. So Erasmus and what happens? Yes. So now, what are you going to do when you got a barcode that comes up? Somebody else has to...
7 of
Florida. What's the great thing about 7 of Florida?
It's got a lake and a beach.
Lake and a beach. Anybody else got it? Not always. Try it, though. Yeah, get closer. See. Yes, I'm sorry. You have to follow my channel. Otherwise, so what comes up? You got it? Virginia, okay. Anybody else? You have to follow my channel. So what it comes up with is a QR code. Here's another picture over here. You can use it. The QR code then takes you to a text that says, shout out your hometown and something great about it. So every person's going to shout out something else. So as you worked on this in groups, you come to an activity that I think is a lot of fun, right? How many people think that's a fun thing? Again, we built it with apps in ways you wouldn't have thought about it, right? Who would think about putting a QR code as an Erasmus link? But it means you either have to have a friend with a QR code reader, or you have to know the trick where you take a screenshot and your QR code reader goes into the camera roll and then reads it. So we always want kids to think outside the app box, and then we never know what they'll do. So if you want to know how to build this one, it's in the handout. The handout will be online. It's called How to Scavenger Hunt. All right, how many people learned something? Yay, okay. So thank you. Let me go back and show you again where the handouts are. But that was, and here's the, this is the QR code. If you have a QR code reader, you'll be able to just look at that. So you can shoot at that and you'll see what they saw. Because it's a text message, right? So if you go to QR code stuff, you can put in a website, or you can put in a text message or whatever you want. So everybody should be able to see the thing about your hometown, right? Yes, somebody else. Home of the Cleveland Browns?
That's where they train.
All right, that's where they train. Yes, somebody else? Fort Scott, Kansas. Anyway, that's the clue and what fun it is to be able to walk your way through it. So this is sort of a short version of a little app that can go in a lot of different ways. You can put in the soundtrack from North by Northwest and have the next clue on the northwest corner of the room. People have to use a compass to figure out where Northwest is, but when they do, then they have the clue. So expand your minds. Thank you very much for coming. If you need more information or you want the handouts, I'll pull up again that for you. It's right here. Some fun, huh? Isn't that weird? I feel like I should be playing the 59th Street Bridge song now.